I've included a link to a bit of history, the very first act by any of the colonies, the province of Massachusetts Bay, as it was then known. Its first act against the crown was actually called the Committee of Safety, and it was headed by John Hancock. And the link is to this document regarding the Massachusetts Committee of Safety. This is going back to the time of approximately 1774. This was the birth moment. This was the start of the revolution. And it happened in Boston, and it was, I just was struck that it was called the Committee of Safety, and what struck me more was looking through several of the history books that have been used in our high schools over the past few years, and they don't mention this much. I think it's because the Committee of Public Safety was headed by Robespierre a few years later in France, and maybe some historians don't like mentioning that we were the first, but this was simply to enable Lexington and Concord to take place, enable the start of the entire thing to take place, and oddly enough, called the Committee of Safety. And that brings me to something I've been obsessing over, and some of you know I've wondered about them for a long time. I fixed a lot of safety pins. There's even a video on this channel about replacing a spiral. This model safety pin is the representative of New York. It was known as the New York Safety. The reason it's the New York Safety, Waterman was based in New York at the time, and this later gained popularity with jewelers in Europe and became known as the Continental Safety. It's easy with extruded silver or to wrap silver around a mandrel and to weld the silver and form a cap, form a little end cap, form the barrel up to about here, and you've formed a Continental Safety. The Boston Safety, you have to get much finer silver, form a taper here, and the jewelers that Moore contracted would even frequently go all the way up into the threads. And this separate part, if you did this as well, you had to get these different diameters, and a separate part. It was much more effort for a jeweler to make a Boston Safety than what later would become the ubiquitous Continental Safeties. This helped me save for college, because they broke. They broke all the time. There's no rod in this cap. When the nib goes out and somebody accidentally puts this on, they're going to crush the nib if they don't remember just in time what they're about to do. They're a bit more difficult to disassemble. Usually this rod here has a little offset. Is this one I've already pre-loosened. And even then it's still difficult. This little spiral here breaks all the time, and It also increases the volume needed in the barrel. This volume is taken up that could have gone to ink capacity. Especially given that once the rod is there, you have all this ebonite taking up your ink capacity. And it's very, very fragile. Now the Boston safety was acknowledged by L.E. Waterman as being a better type of safety. Very, very tight fitting. Likely they had put shellac in there. But it is threaded. But, there's wax. And there is a threaded nut. And you can't access the cork that may have just gone bad. In fact, on this one it has. Because you need expansion pliers, you need a special tool, and you have to be very careful with that. And as it is with the Waterman, if you didn't know about that offset and that rod and how to safely remove it, you'd likely break it in the attempt to fix the broken spiral. So repairing these over the years and finding so many of them broken, gradually led me to want to improve the design. And the main reason to improve the design was basically due to certain artists that were obsessed with these pens, that would be desperate for you to fix them. And I started asking them, why? Why do these have to be fixed? Why is it so important? And it wound up being a situation where, and this is a banker model, more extended the back so that as you're holding it, because it frequently was wet cork holding it back, and if you were flexing it violently, your thumb would be here, and it would prevent it from going back. The main reason that artists wanted these pens fixed, and right up until the older artists started to pass away, even if it was a shaded, miserable condition, lady safety, if you got it fixed and it had a nice nib, it would get a premium and they would like to use it with India ink. The thing about a safety is that when you're storing it, and I had to explain this even to the show organizer at Boston this year, it magically is bathed in the ink. This cap is like a cork over this. And the funny thing is that while it's being bathed in the ink, you can shake them violently. And the ink isn't going to escape. You can't do this with other fountain pens. If you whip it like this, the ink is going to expand, and through centrifugal force, it's going to flood your inner cap, and it'll be a mess, and you'll unscrew the cap, and the ink will drool out of the cap. With the safety, provided you open it top up, of course, if you open it like that, it's a comic error. You open it top up, because gravity works that way, and don't laugh. People do it. If you get a safety, you'll find occasionally, if you're too used to other pens, you'll make this mistake where you'll open it sideways, or any angle other than up is generally not recommended. But because it's bathed in the shellac containing inks, the bonding agent-containing inks, those with gum arabic, it's continuously moist, wet, literally bathed in the ink. In the inner cap, it could be high humidity, but it's not bathed in the ink, and there's still some evaporation that can go on in the inner cap, especially if the inner cap is vented, so you wind up with that shellac all over your nib and gunking up your feed, and the pen doesn't work the next time. So these old illustrators and artists who liked the safeties, despite the fact that they were generally just black hard rubber, and there's a reason for that, black hard rubber, ebonite, is tolerant of many of the solvents of odd inks that these people used to use back then. And plastics are decidedly not. And I'll do a demonstration outside because some of the chemicals I test with the ebonite, testing an O-ring and ebonite. Now the O-ring can swell in response to some chemicals. So it's advisable if you're thinking of using an ink formulation you thought up in your own head, before you risk your pen, just drop the O-ring that goes into your pen with a feed, a cheap ebonite feed that you can find, perhaps the feed of a Noodler's Charlie, and see what happens. And if nothing happens, then chances are you can use that formulation in a safety pen that has the same components. Because Noodler's has made a safety pen, and it's entirely ebonite. And the only vulnerabilities it has are any vulnerabilities to ebonite and to that O-ring. And unlike these safeties and the New York safety, it's the only expansion pliers you need is the thumb and the forefinger. That's all. The rest is just up to how strong your grip is. See this little edge here that goes down? Well, the end cap slides over it just fine. But unlike in the old Moore safety, where you need expansion pliers and you have to remove that little piece of wax and anything else they put in there to remove a threaded nut, with the Noodler's safety, you unscrew. No expansion pliers needed. The O-ring went on the threaded end. That's it's a trick you can do. You just push the nib and the feed forward, and then you the O-ring will pop over the threaded end, and you'll be able to push it out of the threads, because when it's against the wider rod, it's fairly tight. In fact, there's a test before it's released of a certain amount of pounds per square inch of air pressure to determine that the safety pen is sound. But as you can see, and this feed here, this pen is a prototype pen, and I've been using it quite a while. It's the final prototype of several. And as some of you know, this has been it's been a long project to get the price down. There's a lot of threading, a lot of parts. It's in ways more complex than a piston filler, and the material absolutely religiously had to be all ebonite because of what artists need this for. It has to resist many chemicals. This was a challenge to get it affordable, and I think it is affordable. The full retail for this pen is going to be $55, which adjusted for inflation for a safety pen, that is a very, very good deal. Unlike the Waterman, Moore had an invention. This rod inside the cap engages a slot in the feed. It can't crush the nib. It is not possible for this pen to crush the nib. Always, no matter what, you will not be able to screw the cap on until you allow that nib to go into the chamber. This idea is such a good idea that when a certain German company made what they called a safety, but did not bathe the ink in the ink, therefore it lost any benefit of being a safety, and it was piston filling. So, obviously, it can't bathe the nib and the feed in ink. They actually put a rod on the end of the cap, the inner cap, in order to remind the user that the nib was still extended. In the original Moore, the sealing plug was a piece of soft metal, and it was next to impossible to remove. In fact, you can't even see any threads here at all. Very difficult to get in there and remove it and replace it if anything happened. This clip is set in the cap with little gouge claws, and when it comes off, it's a pain. It's a real pain. And this clip is just a washer clip. It's a similar clip to what's on any Noodler's Conrad. And you can fix it. If push comes to shove, this part is fairly easy to access. Here's your wrench. Thumb, forefinger. The entire mechanism is engineered to be dealt with by your thumb and your forefinger. Unfortunately, now this is a Boston safety pen, but there is an imprint on it that says the Boston Safety Pen Noodler's Ink Company. That was the last step in this final prototype to get them to Boston, and there's a carrier that normally, if you absolutely positively must get it there on time, always gets it there on time, and was supposed to get these here by last Wednesday and Thursday, and now they're just plain delayed. And they generally don't have problems. They've been a good carrier in the past. Most of you know who I'm talking about. But they're not going to be available. I can only show this prototype. Because the carrier wasn't able to deliver, it's highly unlikely that by the time Sunday reaches us that these will be available. But what I can say is that the prototype is a success. It has performed flawlessly, and they are being produced, and they will be available in at least some numbers for this upcoming holiday season, and they will be available at your local Noodler's retailer. Possible exception might be in the state of Texas, where El Paso, the Dallas-Fort Worth area, and San Antonio will have these pens, but I don't think they'll be available in Houston. And other than that, pretty much every Noodler's dealer in the country and in the UK. Speaking of England, at the Boston show, there'll be a little demarcation line at the end of the Noodler's Inc. table, because on one side, the British are coming, and the British will be there. We're actually, I don't know if it's in their honor or not, but these 1 ounce bottles will be available at Boston. I don't know if it will be a product after Boston. If people like the idea a lot, then it'll be continued. The product that this ink was designed for is the safety pen. This is a water-based ink that has a bonding agent. It's water-based and doesn't have any alcohol and doesn't have any vicious solvents, any acetone or anything in it. Because if somebody mistakenly fills one of the other Noodler's pens, which I hope you don't do with this ink, then you can quickly rinse it out, and if you quickly rinse it out, you won't have to disassemble the pen and clean it up. It's literally made just for the safety pen, a pen that bathes the nib and the feed in ink right after you use it. The reason it's been put in the 1 ounce is because at the show, you'll have the ability for $10 to pick up one of these Noodler's Ink dip pens. They're about 130, and I don't know if the product will continue, but $10, and it includes a bottle of this safety ink, which is literally called 1774 Massachusetts Committee of Safety. It's Chairman John Hancock, but the ink, I've dubbed it the Committee of Safety Ink, in honor of that event long ago. And while supplies last, you get to choose your two nibs in your $10 purchase from these vintage nibs. Some of these are much more flexible than the modern equivalents for steel nibs, steel untipped nibs. Those of you who like using this kind of ink, a bonding ink, an India ink, a gum arabic, that type of thing, and who like using dip nibs, I've seen the prices of these get a little out of hand. And I have a quick demonstration. That line there is approximately 1 millimeter. If you watch the scale, I'm going to put this nib, this modern nib, hold it there, and it went 5/6. 4/5/6. This is exceeding the line around 6. This one's matching the line. It's hitting as high as 7. In the fives. This is a good way if you're comparing nibs and you want to settle on a dip pen nib and you're concerned with how much pressure it takes to get flexibility because you're using a soft fiber paper grade and the nib's going to dig into it a lot and you want to make that number as low as possible, or you're using a fairly tough paper and you want the nib to scratch into it and penetrate it with the ink, then you want something with a higher number. But this is an extremely useful way to determine the amount of pressure necessary to get a given metal nib, a nib design, to reach a certain desired width of maximum flex. These are the nibs while supplies last. You get to pick two of any of these. You can try it out on your thumbnail, see how flexible they are. Some of them are very, very flexible. One of these and one of these 1 ounce bottles of a bonded ink. Should also be noted, on the top of each box of these Committee of Safety inks is a dot of the ink, because this ink actually, it writes on high gloss coated papers. It takes a bit to dry, but once it dries, you can actually use watercolors over it. You can use all sorts of different types of inks, different types of paints, different types of media surrounding these outlines that you did with your pen. And this is something a lot of Noodler's customers have been asking me about for a while. They wanted a permanent ink that has a sheen to it, that is completely smear resistant. With regular fountain pen ink, when you flex the nib to a huge extent and you're on a paper grade that resists feathering and you have an ink that resists feathering, and there's that giant dome of ink on the page and it's not penetrating, it's just going to sit there and dry. Well, without a bonding agent, a lot of it can't access the cellulose of the paper. And it can, as you push a highlighter over it or a watercolor brush, it can rub off and smear. That's where the bonding agent comes in. That's why the artist wanted safety pens. they wanted that outline of a cartoon of some Warner Brothers type art. They wanted that to stay rigid, to not pollute the other color fields. And that's the goal of this entire project, is basically to please those customers. The safety, the Boston safety had a certain amount of romance and mystery to me. It always had an 1896 patent date on it. They were always the oldest pens I'd stumble into. You'd rarely ever find a caw or a wort, but in Massachusetts you'd find these. And in the Boston area, when I just got an automobile, if you went up to Peabody and Cambridge and the like, sometimes they'd say, even if you're willing to pay more for this pen, it doesn't matter. The building inspector has a right to all my pens. Or the fellow who owns the two businesses across the bay there, he's got the right to all my pens. And it doesn't matter if you offer $100 more. And I couldn't deal with that. And I encountered it too often in the Boston area. And outside of Boston, where there are pine trees and a lot of forests and fog and bad weather and a lot of snow and sliding off the side of the road, that kind of thing. Out in the boonies, you would find these. They hadn't been picked up by anybody, and they were of an earlier era. An earlier collector would have picked these up in the Boston area. I just never found many up there, not that they'd let me. But in the rest of the state, I would, and I'd encounter people telling stories of how they could use India ink and inks that were very different in this particular pen. And never later on, nothing continued in that line that would bathe the nib in ink like this pen would. So it's been a desire for a very long time, since basically the time when I started fixing them and wanted to improve the design, and I wanted to offer something to those artists that were asking for them all the time, and I never could find enough, and who sincerely needed it for their profession. So it's definitely a pen that's been on the priority list, and it's taken so long that it even missed having a less than two dozen finally make it. So there are a few Noodler's inks that are available in England that are not available in the United States. Prime of the Commons Blue Black. It's been around a little while. Its label has always been an argument between Prime Minister Disraeli and Prime Minister Gladstone about the attributes of the ink. It's unique because when you apply a long enough soak of water or bleach, or it's left out in the sunlight for an eternity, it will always turn a pure prime blue, but it writes blue-black, and it's a security feature. If somebody tampers with a document, if somebody washes it, if somebody does something to it, it will revert to the pure blue. So it's somewhat of a throwback to an earlier time when, as you were writing with a blue-black, it would shift color as it dried and as it aged, and that's in that league. And the final color, the blue, the base, is extraordinarily durable. And this is Brexit. It's a royal purple. Made in Massachusetts, where the rebellion against His Majesty began. It's been popular in England, has not been available in the United States. It's bulletproof. And all of the boxes have always been UK 4th of July. That's how it's labeled. And in case you're wondering, will there be a rebellion in Hanover? That is because King George III happened to be the sovereign of Hanover, Germany, as well. This is an amusing story about a mascot. In this particular town in England, the war with France and Napoleon, it had just begun, and they were worried about spies coming in from the ocean. And this little captain's mascot in a French uniform shows up with a French insignia, and the locals, rumor has it, didn't know what a Frenchman looked like. And the local magistrate took it into his power to hang the French spy. So they hung the monkey because he was in a French uniform, French attire. And rival towns, rival soccer teams derided them as monkey hangers because it was viewed as an act of stupidity. And if you Google this, it's become quite the joke, and now monkey hanger is a proud mascot. They have them at these soccer games in England, and this is one of the purest blues, that most prime bulletproof blue that Noodler's has made, it's been a UK exclusive. It will be available at Boston while the British are visiting. In the back of each monkey hanger label is this. If you you pause it, it should have good enough resolution to show this song that they sing about the monkey. In Massachusetts, I've brought a bunch of this particular ink because Massachusetts, you can read the label and pause it. Massachusetts denied the sales tax holiday and then promptly had its legislature override a veto by the governor for a pay raise, a pretty big pay raise. Some people with three positions got three pay raises. And then they immediately claimed that they needed more revenue because there was a shortfall. It's mind-boggling. But like Brexit, it's not the same ink, but you'll notice when I'm sort of mocking royalty, it's generally purple. With the exception, this goes back to the ink that Kung Tacheng, the pigments in the stones going to the Emperor of China, that the purple as a royal color, it was a harder ink to get in ancient times, and it's one of the reasons it moved all the way to Rome and became royal in Rome. Of course, in China, the royal color is yellow in terms of fabric, but in terms of ink, it was also a royal purple. So, in mocking an aristocrat, it's the perfect color. This is a Massachusetts favorite, a lot of people ask for it each year since it came out, and it's the Union Blue. So the 54th will be available at the table, as well as how I am opening the box so that it doesn't tear. You put the knife under here, pop it, and it won't tear. A lot of people tear their box by hand, and then they tell me they regret it. If you have an object, a flat object, and can open it that way, it will never have that issue. Another political label, fight against aristocracy, if you will, and given the history of Massachusetts residents and the founding of Lawrence, Kansas, and the abolitionist movement, they might have said they were pacifists, but they were definitely pushing for it. No doubt about it. If you plunge a harpoon into a whale, you can't exactly call yourself 100% pacifist. Before I get to the next segment, in the back of every polar purple is this bit of text. And you can read that at your leisure. I believe the resolution's high enough. Who knows, I'll probably get in trouble for that. This is my view of the sturgeon is of a fish that most assuredly rivals the catfish in size. Likely some of the species are bigger than even the largest catfish. Although in the Mekong Delta, I believe there is the largest freshwater fish, and it is indeed a catfish. So it the catfish might top out, but the sturgeon is a strong competitor. And the Russian sturgeons, they have predatory sturgeons. They have those that eat clams and those that migrate to the sea, and they have a lot of them. And it's a fascinating ancient fish. And thinking of the Volga and how cold it gets and how blue it can be, this pen is called the Volga Sturgeon. And it is a music nib Neponset. It will be available at Boston. I believe there are 100 total. And it has not... It's likely not to be continued because a few of the retailers have complained we have too many SKUs for colors of these pens. So it is likely the number of the Neponset colors will be reduced, and this probably will not be available again. If the retailers clamor for it, that's one thing. But if not, then it's going to fade away, and it's fairly limited. Of course, by the Volga, it was Stalingrad. Speaking of royalty, the Mandate of Heaven. I was told that it should have more of the yellow, but I think it's pretty, and like the Volga Sturgeon, it's about 100. in number. These will be selling for $75 at the Boston show. When they run out, it is likely they will not be replaced. So it's probably going to cut the number of Neponset colors in half by the time I'm through. I like these colors so much, I really don't want them to expire, but if the public finds them boring, likewise they'll be 100 in number. These are, it's a white hornet and a yellow hornet. Also will be available at Boston. And because the video is so late, I don't expect to sell out. Probably some people upset with me. If they had known this earlier, they might have made plans. And as a result, they might not be there. So if you do manage to make it on Sunday, chances are you can get anything you want, with one exception. If you want one, they'll be available at a retailer soon enough, but they won't likely be available in Boston. There's an off chance that there might be 21, but at this point, I don't think they run the tightest ship in the shipping business. This artwork will likely, if these were to continue, it would be included with your instruction sheets. The intellectual insect. Also available in terms of Neponsets this color likely has already been discontinued. The Algonquin map. Arctic coral. Black python and pearls. There were three customers who complained in the Conrad version there was a little yellowing in the back. That hasn't been a problem with the Neponset, but the color was discontinued as a result. If there's some yellowing now, I don't want to continue the color because there might be more yellowing in 40 years. And though I might not be here, somebody might bother to research Noodler's ink, and I'd like them to have a pleasant memory. There'll be about 10 of these available, about 10, at least 10 of each of the new pens. There'll probably be more than that, but like I said, total production worldwide around 100 per color. So, but I don't expect them to sell out. It's unlikely. I think if you arrive late in the day at the show, you probably can get whatever you like. So drive carefully and don't rush. This is in the back of each one of the Committee of Safety inks. You can see the posting is just like the Boston safety design of old. And it will be the only image I have of the most recent imprint. This is the most recent imprint. This is the imprint that will be on any pen you order in the future. And it is both on the rear sliding cap and the top cap. Double imprinted. And it does have a specialized feed. That feed is very different from all of the other Noodler's pens. It uses the same nib as the nib creeper, but it is sized in such a way that if you were to stumble into a vintage more, most safety pens had a number two nib. The reason for that is when you have a large safety pen, there's a larger area of evaporation. And generally an artist would write and draw about a page or half a page, and then he'd put the pen away, give it a shake, put it aside a little while, and work on some other part of the art, then take it up again. And that was an adaptation to some of the harsher India inks containing shellac and the like. And the nib would have to be bathed. The only reason I was ever given for why the manufacturers made massive, massive safety pens. A gentleman presented me one, and he said, open it up and put it up near your nose and take a whiff. And it smelled like bathtub gin. It was used to take your nip on time during a church service or some other place, perhaps a legal setting in a courtroom or the like. If a judge wanted to have a little nip in the middle of Prohibition, that was something that was extremely dangerous and forbidden and illegal. And they put it in these large safety pens. And that, I suppose, is a reason for buying them, but you wouldn't want a really huge nib in a safety pen using an ink that has a bonding agent. This is about half the variety of nib creepers that will be at the Boston show. And about half the variety of Ahabs. Ivory Darkness. Will be receiving a complimentary Charlie with an eyedropper for each bottle of regular ink you get. You're already getting an ebonite dip pen with two nibs when you buy a bottle of this. Buying a bottle of this, this is a bottle for the safety pen, and if I gave you a Charlie pen, you would not be able to use this ink in the Charlie pen. So you will not be getting a Charlie pen if you buy a bottle of Committee of Safety. I will say, if the concept is not taken up by the retailers and they don't like the idea of a bonding ink, you could be looking at a collectible. There are about 20 of these bottles, each color. There are four colors. There's Patriot Gunpowder, 1776 green, spelled with an E at the end. after General Greene, who in 1776 was appointed by General Washington to command the Boston facilities as the British evacuated. He's much more famous in the Carolinas than he is in Boston, but he did help out in Boston for that period. This is Harbor Tea with the Tea Company insignia on the bottle. Or in this instance, on both sides of Harbor Tea. This is about the toughest of the group. It's instant antiquity in a bottle, the shading that it does, and the color. It's very tough against UV light and incredibly durable. They're all durable, but that one is 5% more in every measure. Patriot gunpowder should be mentioned that the Patriots, still to this day, the football team, whenever they score, they've got some fellas with percussion guns. The percussion, they might be using flintlocks, but they fire some black powder guns to celebrate the score. Note here the intensity of that ink when it beads up, and it does have a sheen to it. And this is, the paper is gloss paper on these boxes. Bunker Hill Blue. It's also very, very intense. Since some of them are eyedropper form, I'm going to demonstrate the color. If you get this on your hands, don't let it dry. If it dries, see, it's all off because I got it in time. It's water soluble when it's still wet, but when it dries, it's incredibly waterproof, and it will be very difficult to get it off your hands. This crazy product, it's at Home Depot in a very big jug for a very reasonable price. It will remove glue, it'll remove all sorts of things, and it was the only product I found that reliably takes that off of your finger, so much so that it gets right into your fingerprint. It'll even remove the ink from the fingerprint, and there's no trace. You just rub it on and then wash your hands and it's gone. It's good to know that, especially if you're experimenting with this stuff a lot, as I have been. And wash your finger right away. And this is Harbor Tea. There is some gloss to that paper, and it will bind to it. This is Patriot gunpowder. Gone. '76 green after the general. They will take a, especially where there are puddles, you'll notice it's slower to dry in the high areas where there are heavy beads of ink. But it's drying right before your eyes. And speaking of drying, you might recognize this. I filled these 308 cartridges when they were just introduced, and these were near a heat source for the rest of that winter, and they eventually dried out. And I would like to show you, you can see it's thoroughly dried. Tiny bit of moisture still there. If you've ever encountered those old cartridges from the mid-60s, and they look empty, have you ever thought of adding a little bit of water to them? Ink. Some of those cartridges, when I was a kid, had a tiny, tiny, tiny amount of dye way in the lower corner, and the cartridge was still sealed. It had never been opened, and I'd pierce the end, fill it with water, and it was good ink. It provided you agitated it. If you gave it a good shake, you could get it to rehydrate. And it's the same with these. Like the mid-60s cartridges, though those were not biodegradable, this is biodegradable, and if you put it next to a heat source long enough, you can eventually get the ink to dry. But like all of those cartridges back then, you can rehydrate it. And to show you how potent it was, something I thought you might want to know if any of you encounter dried out cartridges from the 60s on. And mind you, even from the 60s, they're still good to this day. Also, only at the Boston show, the bag of prototypes. Oddities that haven't made it to market. Music nib looks like that, with a cap like that. Things that are just odd nib imprints, odd construction, of Noodler's prototypes. And lastly, with only about 20 bottles each, if you do like an ink that has a bonding agent in it, and you're an artist that uses that type of ink, if you can make it to the show, I don't know if we're going to make a second run of this. It depends. If the retailers report that everybody is filling this pen with Noodler's Black and nobody's using the new inks, because you do, at the end of the page, you should recap it and give it a shake and give it a little bit of a rest so that the ink can bathe the nib in the feed and keep everything hydrated. If you don't and you just leave it like this and forget it, answer the phone or something, and just leave it like that, you'll likely have to clean that. It'll dry up and gunk up. The magic of the safety pen is half the battle is how the user utilizes it. You have to be conscious always that this ink is very different than regular fountain pen ink. And the effects can be very different as well. What you can do in terms of artistic expression is much greater in certain papers, and especially gloss and coated papers, than otherwise. And there's a bit of work behind this, and if you like the idea and you like the ink, I suggest you get one of those 20 bottles, because it might not be a product that continues. This is a risk on my part. Most of the people who used these with India ink that I knew have passed away, and this is a concept that's very old and has been forgotten, even by the show organizer. So it's very risky to bring it back, try to introduce people to it again. It's a lot of work to get this down to $55. If you look at the other safeties that have come out fairly recently, they've been in the $700 to $1,400, and one that isn't even a safety at $1,100. And an artist can't use that as a tool. You can take some risks with a $55 pen that you would never take with an $1,100 pen. That price level not only cuts a lot of people out, but it also reduces the utility of the writing instrument and reduces the utility that is within its design to use something like that. That makes it one of the most unique fountain pens ever made. So I hope you'll enjoy the show. I'm sorry I wasn't able to bring more safety pens, but this is official. This is the real deal. This will be produced. This will be available from your retailers this holiday season. It's been a long time coming, but it's finally been done. And with your support, maybe this will have a chance to live as a utilitarian product that can please artists. And my last comment, received some communications about Charlie Hebdo, given that the Charlie pen was named for Charlie Hebdo. I would like to point out to those people, I've never liked Charlie Hebdo. I've never defended what they write, but I do defend strongly their right to draw anything that they care to put on the page. This white piece of paper can get you killed in some places if you put a certain piece of art on it. And the triumph of our civilization is the freedom for individuals to write just about anything on that white page that comes into their mind and not be killed and not be shot and not have somebody come into the offices and wreck you. And it's the very fact that Charlie Hebdo is socialist and crazy In my own opinion, that made them the perfect example of my support of freedom of expression and free speech, because they were the polar opposite to myself. And that is why the pen was named the Charlie. It's the very heart and soul of the entire exercise of using these writing instruments is that First Amendment, that freedom of expression and free speech. It's the power that's in this bottle that you put through your hand, that life force, that drawing that, unlike a lot of computer drawings, that's really you, that's really your hand, and ensuing generations can practically see your hand move in that artwork, in that writing. And that is why the Charlie Pen was named the Charlie Pen. They were the perfect example of a polar opposite supporting the idea of free speech and free expression. I hope to see you at the show. I hope you enjoy it.